Yeah, I got two records here. One singing live, and one's with the records. Bill, I just finished reading a very delightful interview. Not an interview, but a review in Variety, which, of course, is the Bible of show business. And they had wonderful things to say about you and your recent appearance at Red Fox's restaurant or theater or club or whatever it is in Los Angeles. But the thing that annoyed me is they said, Bill Kenny's making a comeback, and we didn't know it. I had never had the feeling you were making a comeback. You've never really been that far away from it, but you haven't played Los Angeles in how many years?
15 years, Jack. Mm-hmm. It has been 15 years. As a matter of fact, it sort of surprised me when I read it, and then I realized what it was. The last time I was in Los Angeles in Hollywood proper, Jack, was when I had the quartet, you know. Mm-hmm. So this time, being back as a single, it was virtually a new act as far as they were concerned. And it was such a wonderful reception. I mean, the write-up was really fantastic, and it makes you feel very grateful and thankful to God, Jack, when people say that you haven't changed and your voice seems to have gotten better. And these are the kind of comments that I received, and it was really a thrilling thing, Jack.
Do you sing a lot, Bill, in this day and age still? Do you sing, you know, like in the bathtub and around the house and on the golf course? Do you keep in training is what I'm getting at?
Well, no, Jack, I don't. As a matter of fact, I don't sing at all unless I'm on the stage, and this is something lots of people in the business have asked me about. Or, as a matter of fact, Victor Moan, a lot of the guys ask me why it is that I don't vocalize.
Yeah.
I used to do it a lot, Jack. As a matter of fact, when I did, I also had a dressing room table full of patent medicine sprays, you know. I was kind of concerned about what was happening, and then finally, one day, something seemed to have come over me, and I suddenly realized that what I do, I didn't give myself. And God gives us all something, as you know, Jack. And if this is true, and we know it is, then how can we find out exactly what the mechanics are? We can't. It's like a kid who has a watch, and over a period of time, why he takes the watch apart to try to find out what makes it tick. And this is exactly what I was doing. And this isn't something unusual, Jack, because most of the singers do the same thing. They find themselves in a perplexed state for a period of years, and finally somewhere along the line they sort of, well, they receive a revelation. And when this happens, Jack, it's a marvelous thing, because it takes away all mental pressure. Mm-hmm. In other words, there's no such thing as tightening up, things like that, which happens when you're younger in the business. But I don't practice, I don't rehearse, I don't vocalize. I'll take a new song or something to learn it. Mm-hmm. That's entirely different. But as you know, Jack, I'll play golf and go from the golf course to the concert stage, and I have no problems there at all, thank God.
You seem to be different from the rule, because Bing has mentioned from time to time that a singer is just like a person playing golf or doing anything else where you use your muscles and you're using them right there in your throat. The fact that he feels that he lost it, because, and Bing admits that he's lost his voice, is not what he used to be, because he said he never ever kept in training, and he felt that a singer should keep singing all the time to keep your voice right up there.
Jack, I disagree intensely. I think, frankly, that Bing's problem was drinking.
Yeah.
This I believe firmly. I don't drink, as you know, and not that I have anything against it. I just don't like it. If I liked it, Jack, as you know, I'd be a rummy, because everything I do the extreme. But I do know for a fact that drinking does have an effect on the voice. I learned a long time ago that you don't drink cold drinks when you're singing. It's fantastic, Jack. I mean, this is true in the sense the voice is a musical instrument. Mm-hmm. As you know, you can take any instrument at all, whether it be a guitar or a saxophone, and you put it in a cold spot. If a draft hits it, it definitely affects the tone. Well, the same thing applies with a voice, a speaking voice too, as a matter of fact. If you take a cold drink of water, ice cold water, when you're talking, it will cause the vocal cords to constrict. And this is bad. But other than that, Jack, if you keep yourself physically healthy as much as possible, and that is you don't misuse yourself, then, I mean, as you know, maybe you don't know it, but the voice does not really mature until you reach around your 50s. Mm. This is something I learned from a lot of the opera singers. So it isn't that at all. I mean, what Bing is saying is not true. Bing had a gift. So if you have a gift, there's no reason in the world why you have to keep trying to keep it in form, so to speak. A person who learns through a vocal coach or a vocal teacher, then this person definitely has to practice, because what they're doing is not naturally a part of them. But any person who has a natural speaking voice or natural singing voice definitely does not have to rehearse. This is not true.
Bill, I want to play something of your voice in the beginning. I'm going to play one of your sides from 38 or 39 that your first big hit came along?
Yes, 39.
If I didn't care. And while I cue up this record, why don't you give the folks a little bit of a background of the song that today is your total identity? Anybody hears If I Didn't Care, they know what it's all about, but do they know where it came from and how you stumbled across it?
Ah, God bless you. It brings back wonderful memories, too. Let's see now. It goes back in 1939. I'll never forget it because I had the quartet then, the Ink Spots, and we were playing a club up in Binghamton, New York. As a matter of fact, we were working very hard. We went on around 7 at night, and we sang for a half hour, and then we sort of relaxed for 10 minutes. And this went on from 7 o'clock in the evening until 2 o'clock in the morning.
Ooh.
And it was rather disgusting at times, very discouraging. We were doing the same thing then, the same format. I was singing the song, and the bass man was talking the second chorus. We arrived in Baltimore, Maryland, where I was raised. I was born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, but I was raised in Baltimore, Maryland. And on arriving there, I was rather disgusted, and I decided right then and there that I would do a single, as I'd planned to do when I first came to New York. Incidentally, Milton Berle's brother, Phil Berle, brought me to New York the first time. The theater said to me, as we went to the rehearsal room in the theater, this was around 6 o'clock in the morning, he said, "I know you're going to sing your hit song, Bill." And I looked at him, I said, "What hit song?" He said, "Something about Do Care or Don't Care." The rest of the fellows and myself, we had no idea what he was speaking about. And finally he said, "Well, go out on the avenue within the next hour or so and you'll hear it." So about an hour or so later, we went out on the avenue and every jukebox along the avenue was playing If I Didn't Care. So we immediately went downstairs to the rehearsal hall and we learned If I Didn't Care, Jack. That was the beginning. And I think that one experience has taught me more than anything else in the world, that everything is definitely planned. We have a tendency to say, "Well, look what I did. I planned it, and it came out exactly as I planned it. I worked hard for it." But unless God himself decrees it to happen, Jack, it won't happen. We were about to break up. And yet from out of the blue came If I Didn't Care, and that was the beginning of the Ink Spots.
Well, prior to this, of course, the Ink Spots were best known as what we might call a scat group of the time, where you were doing up-tempo things.
That's
not
true.
Not the syrupy ballads.
No, not the syrupy ballads, Jack. As a matter of fact, they were together before I joined them. They were about to break up.
Mm-hmm.
They were doing strictly instrumental work and scat singing, as you said. And me being a ballad singer, when I joined them, with the stipulation that I would be able to sing ballads. And they agreed to this. And as it turned out, the first ballad I sang was If I Didn't Care.
Now, Jack Lawrence wrote this. Do you know anything about him? Have you ever had any connection with Jack Lawrence? Have you ever met the man that wrote this song?
Yes, I did meet him, Jack, many years ago. I haven't seen him now in, oh my gosh, in many years. It was a peculiar thing because when he wrote If I Didn't Care, it had been put out about 3 years before we received it.
This is a fact, Jack.
And as it turned out, Dave Capp of Decca Records suggested that I sing the song, and I did. And we had no idea that the song would do anything, because at that particular time, too, Jack, everything was up-tempo. Ballads were dead. And so we more or less had the distinct honor of bringing ballads back to life again.
Well, was this not the B-side? I think you were betting on the other side of the record, which was a terrible thing called...
Knock-Kneed Sal on the Mourner's Bench.
Terrible,
Jack,
record. Terrible.
I still can't understand why it didn't become a hit.
They've never reissued it, which is pretty nice. Can you, just before we play this original recording of yours, do you have any recollections about the recording session itself? It was an East Coast session, perhaps New York City. And what did you record at the same time as you did this one? How many sides?
Just the two, Jack.
Just the two.
Just the two. Mm-hmm. And it was on the East Coast in New York. And just the two sides. As a matter of fact, our contract was a very slim one. Mm-hmm. It called just for two sides, and there were no royalties, Jack.
Say again?
No royalties, believe me. We received $25 each for If I Didn't Care.
And how much did it make for Decca Records and continues to make today, I wonder, because it's still in the catalog.
You are right, Jack. It's fantastic. I mean, it's in so many millions now, it's not even funny. The strange thing about the new...
Million?
I'd say 5 million easily.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, 5 million. And it's funny because If I Didn't Care was something that it was the beginning. I mean, so many times we hear people in show business who get nothing for their first initial, tryout. But from it all comes so many wonderful things,
exactly.
Jack.
Exactly. Exactly what a hit tune means to an artist today. The price goes up. They can go into the smartest supper clubs in the country. And this was the door opener for you then.
Opened right up wide. And I mean, there were places then, Jack, that we never dreamed existed.
How many times have you sang it, Bill Kenny?
Oh, my goodness. Let's see now. Every time.
No. Tell me, was there ever a verse to this song? If there's a verse, I've never heard of it.
No, there's no verse at all, Jack.
None at all.
No verse.
Will it hurt you to hear it again?
No, it'll thrill me.
Young Bill Kenny, this is you in 1939. Try to remember.
If I didn't care more than words can say, if I didn't care, would I feel this way? If this isn't love, then why do I thrill? And what makes my head go round and round while my heart stands still? If I didn't care, would it be the same? Would my every prayer begin and end with just your name? And would I be sure that this is love beyond compare? Would all this be true if I didn't care for you?
If I didn't care, honey child, more than words can say. If I didn't care, would I feel this way? Darling, if this isn't love, then why do I thrill so much? And what is it that makes my head go round and round while my heart just stands still so much?
If I didn't care, would it be the same? Would my every prayer begin and end with just your name? And would I be sure that this is love beyond compare? Would all this be true if I didn't care for you?
We're talking with Bill Kenny, and a little more conversation with Bill in just a minute or so after this.
The Strand Theater and Dad's Cookies has a special treat for the whole family. A madcap millionaire and a nutty 900-year-old gnome get hilariously hung up as a lonely he-gnome searches for his lost she-gnome.
You want to find gnomes, don't you?
Not with you, I don't!
But that's just part of this marvelous madhouse, starring Walter Brennan in a dual role. Gnomish Tom Lowell, those Mary Poppins kids, Matthew Garber and Karen Dotrice, and Edwin. Watch out for all the crazy comical catastrophe. In Walt Disney's The Gnome-mobile.
Mom, Dad, and all the kids can see the Gnome-mobile free, but hurry. Send your dad's cookie box tops to Dad's Gnome-mobile today. Entries close midnight tonight. This positively your last chance to win free tickets to the Gnome-mobile. Send your name, address, and your dad's cookie box tops to NW. And hurry, midnight tonight.
Bill, this really isn't my time slot. As you know, this is Mr. Dave Abbott's spot. He's in holidays right now, so we're doing a week of interviews with visiting celebrities, and even, in your case, resident celebrities. And the concept of Dave's show from time to time, constantly, is phone calls. Are you adverse to accepting a few calls, provided they're not calls to say, hi, how are you? Do you want to try a couple? Go ahead and see. Maybe they want to try some questions on you.
Cullen, what's gone wrong? I was listening to Jack Cullen and Bill Kenny, and the whole damn thing went off quiet. It's been gone off now for nearly 7 or 8 minutes.
You broke your what? Jack Cullen here. Can I help you? Hello?
Yes,
what's the problem, lady?
Well, I was listening to Cullen and Bill Kenny, and it's all gone off. There hasn't been a sound for about 7 or 8 minutes.
There hasn't? Just a minute, lady. I'll turn my radio on. Oh, that's me. No, I'm sorry. I just turned mine on. Yours is broken, okay? I'm sorry. Thanks for calling.
It can't be.
It is, lady. Here, lady. Well, I'll turn my... Just a minute. Woof, woof. No, I'm sorry. We're on the air, lady. At least in Vancouver. Perhaps where you're calling from, I'm not so sure. But our number here, if you'd like to talk with Bill Kenny, you always get a winner like that every time, is Mutual 47912, which makes me feel awfully grateful that I do not normally do that which is known as the talk show. And honestly, honey, if my radio's working here, yours has got to be working out there somewhere. Anyway, before anybody checks in, shall we move on, old fellow here?
All right, Jack.
And talk a little more about the times of Bill Kenny.
Oh.
As a resident of Vancouver, what do you spend your time doing around this town of ours?
Well, Jack, I play golf, you know, and I love it. It's something that mostly everyone in show business does nowadays, as you know. And if you don't play a halfway decent game, you're ostracized.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been playing quite a bit of golf. And between the engagements, you know, like in the Orient and in the States, I sort of play a lot of golf. I don't do very much work in Canada other than just the odd private thing, you know, Jack.
You're big in Sacramento, I hear, though, and of course...
You're right.
Is it Sebastian's you always appear at in
That's
Sacramento?
Right.
And you, Bill always says, well, Jack, we're leaving town now, we're going to be gone for 2 weeks, and it usually stretches into at least 6 weeks, and they keep holding you over and holding you over.
That's true, Jack. Well, as you know, and many people do who are listening, Sacramento is the capital city of California, and I love it there. I enjoy it immensely whenever we go. Audrey and I have a ball. She swims and I play golf, and then naturally sing at night. But it's really wonderful. But there's still no place like Vancouver. Believe me, Jack. I mean, we go away, it seems we just can't get back quickly enough.
But Bill, aren't there penalties for this too, as not being, you know, not a resident of the United States? That those lucrative bookings, do you want them? Do you really care? I sometimes wonder.
Well, really, I don't care. I tell you why, Jack. I have an office, as you know, in Beverly Hills.
No, I didn't know.
Yes, I do. And they naturally do the booking. And lots of times I find that if it's something, I prefer what we call the captive audience. I prefer like the auditoriums and the hotels too. And nightclubs I don't care too much for. I've never cared too much for nightclubs, Jack. And but there are times you have to play them. As a matter of fact, I'll be up in Lake Tahoe in October, see. And it isn't too bad there. But as we say in the business, no matter how beautiful a nightclub may be, it's still an upholstered sewer. And this is true.
I hope Izzy and Alex Louie are listening, and Ken Stoffer. Oh, you're going to get some bookings in this town. Would you believe the Smiling Buddha? Let's listen to another one by Bill Kenny right now, who loves nightclubs.
Heaven, when I see you smile for me, my Diane, and though everything's dark all the while, I can see you, Diane. You have lighted the road leading home. Pray for me. when you can. But no matter wherever I roam, smile for me, my Diane. You have lighted the road leading home. Pray for me when you can. But no matter wherever I roam, smile for me, my
I'll be back to talk more with our guest, Bill Kenny, in just a minute after this news and the Are You Listening result. Jack Cullen back here, substituting this week for Dave Abbott, and nicely so, with a good friend. And tonight, not a taped interview, but Bill is in the studio with us, and we've decided we'd accept not a lot of calls, but a few. We have somebody on the phone right now, Bill, that would like to talk to you. Do you want to go carry on?
Shirley, hello?
Mr. Kenny?
Yes.
Are you going to have a TV show like you had a couple of years ago this fall?
God bless you. I don't know for certainty yet. As a matter of fact, we're in the middle of negotiations now with the East, you know. As you know, all of the things are really controlled back East.
Yeah.
And that's something that, similar to the system in the States for the longest time. I mean, the New York controlled the TV, and Hollywood had to sort of kowtow to them, you know.
Well, I must admit, it's one of the nicest shows, you know, we ever watched.
God bless you. And, thank you for saying so.
And there is some chance then that you might be on TV.
There is a great chance,
yes. Thank you very much.
Pleasure's mine.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
As far as your career goes, you came in a little late in the television era. You were very, I know you did a lot of radio things. You and I were kind of kibitzing and yucking a bit earlier about the fact that you did, you did the Bing Crosby show, the Philco, the Kraft Music Hall. You did even the Jack Benny show, I remember once, too.
That's true, I did, Jack. And you know, there's something else, Jack. Back during 1940, this is the early 40s, when TV was starting in New York, I helped to pioneer it, Jack. And this is something that a lot of people don't know. I with the act, naturally, and that was when you had about 6 feet deep. No, 6 feet long,
mm-hmm.
3 feet deep. And that was the space you stood in. And if you just moved your head too far, you'd be out of focus. And the lights were the old Klieg lights, Hollywood Klieg lights, and it was intensely hot. And they used us quite a bit because of the pigmentation of the skin, you see. They were working on color TV, too. Mm-hmm. And they found with us they could photograph much better without using heavy makeup. So, you see, we did help to find a TV even coming in, Jack.
You want to pick up that phone and see if there's a lot? Probably somebody that hasn't got the radio working
CKNW.
Tonight.
CKNW?
Yes, could I speak to Bill Kenny, please?
Yeah, Bill Kenny speaking. Thank you.
Bill Kenny speaking?
Uh-huh.
Say, listen, could you sing that song, If?
You don't sing it all day, but if he wants to.
I surely can, God bless you.
Hey?
I surely can.
Well,
you've
I'm
got the record.
What?
Beg your pardon?
And I'll tell you, I've been trying to get that record for a long time. You were up at Kidmat, weren't you?
Yes, that's right.
I was in the hotel there.
Oh, bless your heart. It brings back wonderful memories, too.
Hey?
Brings back wonderful memories.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I've I asked you about it, and you said, well, why didn't you ask for it?
Yeah, I surely...
will you sing it tonight?
I surely will.
If not, I'll play.
Thank you very much.
If not, Jack will play it, he says. Okay?
Okay, boy.
God bless you, and thanks for calling.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
You know, Bill, that's something, you know, that I learned about you, because, you know, we've all been... We've known each other socially for a long time. I know that occasionally at your apartment you play around with a ukulele. You haven't got one here. But would you do a request for me tonight?
If it's possible,
here,
Jack, sure.
Stand up on your feet and walk right over here.
That's it.
This, sir, is a piano. I can't play, but I've heard you do, You play a piano nicely, and you also do a number called, is it Without a Song That You Sing? There's something that you sing, and nobody has ever heard Bill Kenny play a piano and do a song. Now, you're blushing, you're getting all upset, but I put you on the spot, and you've never turned me down on a thing yet, and I know you're not now.
Jack, tell you, well, you know, I'm not what you might call instrumentalist, you know that. But this is one song I do love, Jack, and I like to sort of fool around with it, if this can help a bit.
Without a song, the day would never end. Without a song, the road would never bend. When things go wrong, a man ain't got a friend. Without a song, I've got my troubles and woes. Sure as I know the Jordan will roll, I'll get along as long as a song strong in my soul. I'll never know what makes the rain to fall. I'll never know what makes the grass grow tall. I only know there ain't no love at all. Without a song.
Come on, that's it. Is that more? Say, this is a little early for us to get working down here this evening. Very nice, Bill. We'll walk back over here to the control console. That was you're a good sport. You always have been. You know, usually when people come in, stars, they'll never sit down and play the piano and sing as you do. You've always been very easy to work with. And just because you've been so decent to me, I'm going to let you hear a commercial. I'm all heart tonight.
Clean the bathroom. Looks lovely. Why not a spray of Florient to make everything fresh and sweet-smelling?
Don't forget the Florient.
Don't forget the Florient.
If I know what's good for me, I'll get one more of those little tiny ones.
Like to win a $50,000 gold bar or a brand new car? This year's PNE has over $100,000 in program prizes. A car a day given away, plus the grand prize, a $50,000 bar of gold. See it on display at PNE 67. See Champion Livestock, the Hobby and Craft Show, the Horse Show, and all the other exciting attractions. Bring your camera and come to the biggest ever Pacific National Exhibition, August 19th to September 4th in Vancouver.
You know, Bill, if we were doing this a little later on in my own time period here, we'd have the studio swarming with people. We'd have a resounding bit of applause there, but it was nice of you to stand up and clap for yourself. I'm kidding. Come on, try another call here. See who's on the blower.
CKMW.
Yes, Jack. Well, I just want to compliment you. You have a tremendous artist there tonight.
Well, you tell him. He's listening right now. Go ahead and talk to him.
Mr. Kenny.
Yes, hello.
It is a pleasure listening to you, and Jack must be a mind reader because he asked for the very tune I was about to phone you for.
Isn't that fantastic? That is fantastic.
You better ask Jack to get you on there at least once every month. I could listen to you every cotton picking day of the week.
I didn't know your brother was in town.
God bless you. Thank you very much.
Just keep up the good work, Mr. Kinney. It's very nice to hear you once in a while like this.
Thank you very kindly.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bill, we're going to go back for a minute right now and remember a thing called the Jabba Jive. You don't get a big part in this, but, you know, getting dirty looks maudry over. No, but seriously, everybody's so used to the nice, mellifluous, soaring tenor voice of Bill Kenny. But folks have forgotten, you did some of these crazy songs, and they were big sellers.
You're right. I mean, as a matter of fact, Jack, Jabba Jive was the biggest of the rhythm songs,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
And it brings back wonderful memories to me. Even now and then, I have people to say to me, When I do a show, they say, Bill, would you do coffee and tea?
Oh, you can't do that as a solo.
No,
or
I can't.
Do you?
I don't. I have to explain to them that I didn't sing Jabba Jive. I just did the obbligato in the background, you know.
What was your part, so I'll know?
Well, let's see. Well, I did a little harmony, you know.
Yeah.
I love coffee, I love tea, I love the Jabba Jive and it loves me. But I did, I love coffee, I love tea, I love the Jabba Jive and it loves me. That's the harmony to the melody, you see.
Gee, let's listen for Bill's big part in this one. Who were the other members of the group at this time?
Well, that was Deke Watson. He was the rhythm singer. That's the man who takes the lead in this particular song. Yeah. And there was Hoppy Jones, the bass, naturally. Mm-hmm. And there was Charlie Fuqua. He did the baritone.
So here's the ink spots. Vintage 40?
Vintage 44.
Okay.
Beautiful.
I love coffee, I love tea, I love the Jabba Jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Jabba and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup,
boy.
I love Jabba, sweet and hot. Whoops, Mr. Moto, I'm a coffee spy. Shoot me the pot, now pour me a shot. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. Oh, slip me a slug from the wonderful mug. I got a rug just stuck in the jug. A slice of onion and a raw one. Raw one. Waiter, waiter, percolator. I love coffee. I love tea. I love the Jabba Jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Jabba and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. Oh, Boston beans. Soybeans, green beans, cabbage and greens. I'm not keen upon a bean, unless it is the cheery, cheery bean, boy. I love coffee, I love tea. I love the Jabba Jive and it loves me. Coffee and the tea and the Jabba and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, yeah. I love Jabba, sweet and hot. Whoops, Mr. Moto, I'm a coffee pot. Shoot me the pot, now pour me a shot. A cup, a cup, a cup,
yeah.
Oh, throw me that glove from the wonderful mud. I'll cut a rug till I'm snug in the jug. Drop a nickel in the pot, yo. I take them a slow. Waiter, waiter, percolator. I love coffee, I love tea. I love the Jabba Jabba and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Jabba and me.
Yeah.
A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. Boom.
I do believe we're back. Bill, we got another phone call there. You want to take a crack at it?
TKNW?
Yes. Yeah. Bill Kenny?
Yes, speaking.
I'd just like to thank you for the time you're up in Terrace in 1958.
Oh, what beautiful, beautiful. Oh, my goodness. What a time we had. It was wonderful.
The show you put on up there for, people that hadn't heard too much of this in that time.
That's right.
I was the guy who was trying to beat out the ball game. Remember the ball game next door?
Oh, yes.
I was manager of the Legion up there then.
That's right, exactly.
Yeah, and I said if, you said if I could get the ball game out, you'd come down to Legion and
You remember that?
Yeah, I sure do.
Oh, gee, it's wonderful hearing from you.
You did a wonderful thing on that tour for BC in 58 for the whole centennial deal.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed it, too, you know. You know, I love parades anyhow.
Yeah, you were... Well, you made it.
God bless you. Thanks for saying it.
I don't know whether Jack's got it there or you got it there. I heard somebody else earlier tonight, this Rose of Roses, this piece you wrote yourself.
Oh, yes, the Rose of Roses, yes.
You did it up there that night.
Ah.
That's tremendous.
We'll see if we can find it.
Thanks. Jack
My
was
wife
just
and
saying.
I'd like to hear that.
All right, Jack just said we'll see if we can find it for you.
Okay, thank you very
pleasure.
Much, Bill.
Righto, bye-bye, and thank you for calling.
If I'm not careful, I'll turn this into a request show, and we don't want to do that. As a matter of fact, these are Dave Abbott's listeners, you see, that are tonight, and they're the people that call up and say, it's nice to have you in town. I wish you folks would really, and I don't want to get, you know, kind of snarly with you, but really, if you got some, put some questions to Bill, because this guy has 30 years of show business behind him. He's rubbed elbows with the greatest. He has a lot of information that he can give to you. Please don't just call up and say, it's nice to hear you're doing a good job, or I met you in Tawaston or something. If you got something to say, then call up and ask for Bill. I'm beginning to sound like a talk show man. That's not my forte at all. Bill, you've done a great deal of recording in recent years. You've most of your earlier stuff, of course, was for Decca. You've been with Dot. What about the recording horizons these days?
Well, Jack, I think right now, as a matter of fact, it's a statement throughout the business that the big bands are coming back. And I know while in California, the big bands that are touring throughout the states are really in tremendous numbers. And this is a wonderful thing. I am with Dot, as you know. Mm-hmm. I have another recording session coming up very soon. As a matter of fact, I thought that I would record while I was there. But there are a few other songs that I'm trying to get. I have one, if you remember, I called you, Audrey called you one night and asked you about a song that the great, late Paul Whiteman did. Remember that, Jack? You forgot, did you?
Whispering?
That's right.
That was his. That was Paul Whiteman's first record in 21.
In 21.
You remember 1921, Bill? It was an excellent year.
No, I was just a baby then.
I know. I burped you. Want to take another call here?
Seek the end of Bill Kenny.
Is Bill Kenny on the phone?
Yes, speaking.
Oh, well, I used to wait on you a lot in Carousel, and you told me that if I ever got you on the radio, I could ask a request.
Surely it's a
pleasure. For my husband, because his greatest ambition was to meet you. And what I'd like to hear is precious memories.
Precious memories. Jack has everything, and I'm quite sure we'll have that. Bless your heart. It'll be a pleasure, darling.
Oh, thank you very much.
And would you give your my regards, brother, and Jack's also to your hubby?
You bet I will.
All right. Thanks for calling.